A very good evening to MD, debate EMD, SVC, TRC committee, Soul Ranger.
Okay.
Hi. Hi. Good evening. Then come to Gaia. Gaia. Okay, remember Gaia. Not after us. Okay. Then start. Okay. So, of course, and also good evening to my dream class also. So today, by the way, I'm Jackie. Okay. So today my team of five of us, okay, Nikki, Nicole, Cindy, and YY Lin, and myself, will share with you about a book, okay, with the title, A Business and Its Belief. So the idea that helped you the idea, okay? So he is the author of this book, Thomas J. Watson. So he was the son of IBM founder, so joined IBM as a salesman in 1937. So in 1946, he was the vice president of IBM, 1952 as a president, in 1957 as CEO, chairman of the board, an influential member of the President Advisory Committee on Labor Management Policy, and he was a respectful trustee for a number of organizations. So the book, this book is actually divided into two parts, which is part one and also part two. So the part one is about the application and challenge. The part two is about the broader purpose. So myself, we walk you through about the part one, which is the heritage and the challenge. So the first part is actually bringing out the best. Out of 25 industrial corporation in the U.S. in 19th century, there's only two remain in the selected company today. So one retained in its original identity, the other is a merger of seven corporations of that original list. Two of those 25 failed, three others merged and dropped behind. The remaining 12 have continued in business, but each has fallen substantially in its standing. So this story is actually telling us that the success of the corporation is an impermanent achievement, so which can always slip out of hand. Their decline may be due to the technology changes, also the changing taste of your customer, and also the changing fashion, and so on and so forth. So, but the fact remains the same, that some companies manage to flourish while others in the same industry may fail. These differences always link to the things like the business competence, market judgment, and the quality of leadership in the corporation. Each of these is a wildcard factor. While most of the organization always believes that, okay, the business competency, market judgment, and the leadership are the important attributes to the success of the corporation, but IBM was actually have a different thought. Okay. They believe that the success of business depends on how well the organization brings out the great energy and talent of its people. So what does it do to help these people find the common causes with each other? How does it keep us pointed in the right direction despite the many rivalry and differences which may exist among us? And how can it sustain this common cause and a sense of direction through many changes which take place from one generation to another? So let us share with you a show.
Thank you.
structure, you must pass down equity from top all the way to the bottom line. Okay, in other words, the basic philosophy, spirit, and the drive of an organization have far more to do with its relative achievement than to technological or economic resources, organization structure, innovation, and timing. So in appearance, IBM today is quite different from the company it was in 1920, 1930, and 1940. Within a period of two generations, IBM actually has expanded from a small combination of three companies with a revenue of $3 billion in 1916, and their employee is actually grown from a company of 1,002 people to more than 125,000. So IBM product has changed from the tabulated machine with a three hands leg, this is, okay? So to the high power of computer. So some of which can perform at the rate of more than 600,000 calculations per second. So some may say that IBM experience has been unique, that IBM has been successful only because it has an unusual market or because it has been in the market long enough to establish deeper roots than some other organization. Of course, being the right place at the right time with the right product has helped a lot, yet IBM do not think this has been the decisive factor. What contributed to IBM's success was actually IBM's belief. So IBM is still very much the same company it has always been, for while everything else has altered, their belief is actually remained unchanged. Next, I will remind Nikki for the next presentation.
So I will continue with the chapter 2, Helping Find Growth. The belief that built in an organization frequently grows out of the characters, the experiences, and the contributions of a single person. So IBM philosophy actually largely contains in three simple beliefs. First of all, the most important belief that drove IBM is having respect for the individual. So let's see how IBM develops sense of respect in the organization. First of all, they provide employee a sense of job security. Teacher wasn't always have an understanding for the problems of the working men. Moreover, he also recognized the greatest of these problems was job security. So IBM actually did a policy on job security in 1914, where this policy actually helps to develop their people, to retrain them when job requirements change, and to give them another chance if they're experiencing difficulties in the jobs they are in. So IBM also avoid layoff and work interruptions have encouraged their people to respond with loyalty and with diligence on the job. So policy like this actually help the organization to win goodwill of most of their people. So secondly, IBM also provide respect in case of their employees. So let's watch the show first. IBM also provide their employee a sense of fairness. For many these years, IBM benefits were the same for all employees for a given amount of service regardless of rank or positions, such as medical care are the same for all. They also provide the employee continual opportunity for advancement. Because IBM has grown so rapidly, they have created many opportunities for promotions. No matter how great the temptations to go outside of their managers, they always feel with these new jobs for unions. So all the executives actually came up from the bottoms. This has been a great factor in maintaining morale. And lastly, any business needs its wild dust. So let's watch a show again.
We are Team Jaka.
So what is wild dust? In IBM, the frequently refers to the needs for wild dust. It refers to the people that continuously accept challenging work. They move out from their comfort zone. So because IBM believes men who have accomplished great things in large organizations might have done less, if they have been challenged with less, and they would have realized less of their potentials and their individuality. So employees that are being challenged has the highest chance to accomplish more in the organization. So I would pass to Mac presenter, Nico.
Thank you, Nikki. So I'm presenting on the third part, which is service and superiority. The first takeaway is service is a key element for good reputation, and IBM interview an average of 25 applicants for each one they hire. So let's see what happens. They long ago established high standards for a selection of salesmen and customer engineers. So to attract a top quality salesman, they use a sales commission, advances, quotas, and guarantee territories. And school was set up for a salesman, and the training courses now runs as long as 18 months. They interview average of 25 applicants for each one customer engineer they hire. And in its commitment to customer service, IBM learned that it is the best way to serve a prospect was to provide equipment adapt to his requirement rather than ask him to alter the business to fit IBM machines. Next takeaway is a reputation for service is one of the company's principal assets. In IBM, many operations performed by the machine are vital to customers' business. Lengthy breakdowns are disastrous, and in IBM contract, they always offer not only for machine for rent, but machine services, that is the equipment itself and the continued advice and counsel of the IBM staff. Next, it is to better to aim at perfection than that is it is to miss it is to aim at imperfection and key. IBM expect and demand superior performance from each people in whatever they do. An environment which call for perfection is not likely to be easy, but aiming for it is always a good process. In addition to this persistent striving for perfection, an organization will stand up only if willing to take on seemingly impossible tasks. The man who set out to do what others cannot do are the one who makes the discoveries, produce the invention, and move the world ahead. And at the World Fair of 1939, IBM launched the IBM Day. The following year, IBM brought 10,000 of their people to the fair at company expense. And in 1934, the management told the sales force that as soon as the company profit doubled, the IBM convention would be held in Europe, and all salesmen hitting target will qualify for the trip. And in summer of 1962, 187 salesmen who had qualified for the trip traveled to Europe with their wives. And next, when you lose a battle, stay positive. You can't win them all, but the overall picture will be good. What TJ Watson did, probably more than anything else, was to set the tone for IBM. he brought the belief to the company, he brought the spirit and great excitement, but it was also colored by his own good sense of what would be the most appropriate for the time and the situation. When things become difficult and uphill, he could be very optimistic. But when things look good and began to clear up, he forever cautioning against getting complacent about it. This is a necessity for any leader to be a balanced will. And certainly no one can argue with the result. From 1940 to 1946, IBM profit grew 36 times. Next, I will pass to Cindy.
Thank you, Nicole. I'll continue with the new chapter of the new environment. So the first key highlight here is to live by same beliefs through constant changes. So during the first 32 years between 1914 and 1946, IBM have crafted strong corporate beliefs. Now they have to live by those same beliefs through constant change. It means that it's new products, new markets, and a step-generic increase in the company's size. So from the domestic gross revenues of $118 million in 1946, IBM went on until $1.7 billion in 1961. So the employee in the United States has went from 70,000 to almost 80,000. So in the year of 1930s, the engineering people they hired had conventionally electrical or mechanical training. Now they had to look for scores of new disciplines, many of them in critical short supply. So the laboratories began to fill up with specialists in areas of electronics and physics, with chemists, metallurgists, and mathematicians. The operations now demanded basic research in a number of important areas and ran heavily into applied research and engineering. So the salesman has trained to market relatively simply accounting machines, suddenly found themselves responsible for enormously complex million-dollar computer installations. And the customers and engineers enter a new strange new world of electronic testing. So IBM has set up two management schools. One is for junior executives, another 2 years later is for line managers. The school will not only to teach general management, but most importantly, it will to give managers a feeling for IBM's outlook and its beliefs. And after a time, they found that the schools tended to put too much emphasis on management, not enough on the beliefs, so they changed the curriculum. They felt it was vital that the managers be well-grounded in their beliefs. Otherwise, they might begin to get management views differently with the company's outlook. If this were to happen, it might possibly slow down its growth and change the basic approach to the management of this company. So the second highlight point is to implant and keep alive a real feeling for the traditions and belief of the business. So in the year 1956, IBM reorganized the company into divisions and started to emphasize profit as to measure of each division's performance. At the point they begin to see clearly that some division managers become so profit-minded that they lose track of IBM beliefs unless constantly reminded by top management. In one instance, customer engineers were spread too thinly across customer installations. This was good for profit, but the morale of the overlooked customer engineers began to waver. IBM high standards of service were certainly in jeopardy. Corners have been cut on two beliefs, respect for the individual and service to the customers. So from 1946 to 1962, IBM's worldwide population increased by more than 100,000 people. Growth has brought thousands of new managers. The new levels of management have had to face the problem of how to implant and keep alive with these people a real feeling for the traditions and beliefs of the business. A small company attitude, transparent and seamless chain of communication. So it's a showtime again.
Thank you.
So small company attitude is a term IBM frequently use. They want their people to feel that they understand one another, that they have some knowledge of each other's problems and goals. And they want their employees to feel that they always have access to the management, that no one is so far down in the chain of command that he cannot be kept aware of what is going on. And IBM also have a newsletter called Management Briefing. They find that they would be falling short of keeping their middle managers well informed. Hence, the manager briefing like newsletter started and goes regularly to more than 10,000 managers, the majority of whom many companies would call foremen. One of the most unique custom in the IBM family dinner, at least once every 2 years in every one of IBM branch offices around the country, their people, along with their husbands or wives, are asked to dinner with an officer of the corporation to learn what is going on. And the officer will show a half an hour full report on what the company has done in past years. These family dinners keep the executives on the go, but they give an occasion where everyone can get together informally, and they have helped keep the small company attitude alive. IBM also issue letters of congratulations on promotions and jobs well done. And when their people get sick or when they lose their family members, IBM remember them with notes of sympathy or condolence. And chapter 5, what growth and change have taught us? And the key takeaway here is there are two things that an organization must increase far out of proportion to its growth rate if the organization is to overcome the problems of change. The first of these is communication upward and downward. The second is education and retraining. So IBM has learned that a company must be prepared to make a commitment to internal education and retraining, which increases in proportion to the technological change the company is going through. When skill requirements change, it is the job of the corporation to train its people with those new skills. The commitment to education and training is strong within IBM throughout the different areas. For salesmen, this business of school has become an everyday thing. And in the service group, customer engineers must constantly update themselves and learn new skills. Today, IBM has 8 operating divisions and 2 wholly owned, but independently operated subsidiaries. All have the considerable degree of autonomy, sitting over and reviewing the long-range plan and major division is a corporate management committee, made out of the board chairman, the president, and 6 overtop executives. So I'll pass it to my wife.
So now I'll be presenting to you a very quick overview of what the broad purpose is. Due to extremely tight time constraints, I will just go through with you what the whole chapter is about. In this chapter, in this part, the second part of the book, there's about 2 chapters, about 60 pages. Now this book, it is hard to say that IBM, just now we were talking about the internal beliefs of IBM, right? How they believe they should treat their employees, how they believe they should treat their customers. In this part of the book, they explain how they should believe they can contribute to the nation as a whole. Now, this book is written in 1961. So at that time, the American industry is just starting to revolutionize, just starting to implement IT and understand what the internet is about. So at that time, IBM was very successful. They started as simple as Microsoft. So at that time, they became very successful. They started to think internally, what can they do to contribute to society, to the country? And ultimately, what is their purpose in the political scene for the US? So that the whole part of chapter 2, the part 2, I will go straight to the more important aspects of our presentation slide, the similarities between Senti and IBM that we find in this book. Okay? Both IBM and Senti emphasizes on the quality of service to customer by attracting good candidates through good incentive and salary packages. Both IBM and Senti organize family days to strengthen the bond between the employees. Both IBM and Senti share additional profits of their employees in also different ways. IBM brought their employees for trips to Europe and overseas, where Senti distributed profit monetary reform that we experienced recently, right? Similarly to IBM, Senti has placed national interest in its business vision and its beliefs. The well-being of the nation is embedded through Senti beliefs. Both IBM and Senti keep their managers and all employees well informed on the latest management decisions and directions. So that's the end of our presentation. Thank you very much.